This is a book about information dissemination and suppression in Canadian foreign policy, trying to answer the question of why 9 in 10 Canadians think this country is a force for good in the world, despite a long history of Canada supporting empire, British historically, American last half century, and Canadian foreign policy advancing Canadian corporate interests abroad. That is the thrust of what Canadian foreign policy is about, as I've detailed in six previous books looking at different elements of Canadian foreign policy. This book is trying to answer that question of the overwhelming confusion in Canadian foreign policy among the public. People familiar with the responsibility to protect? Most people? Some people not. Basically, the responsibility to protect doctrine is a doctrine Canadian government has been pushing since the Chrétien, Paul Martin times, internationally, saying that it's the responsibility of the international community to intervene, superseding state sovereignty, where there's massive human rights violations taking place. It's the kind of thing that on paper sounds kind of like a good idea, but in practice, no one ever says, let's intervene in Washington when the US is responsible for major human rights violations somewhere. So effectively, it becomes the tool of the powerful to be used against the weak, which is how it was used in the case of Haiti, 2004, and even more explicitly in the case of Libya in 2011. So I submit an op-ed or a blog to the Huffington Post detailing Canadian officials citing the responsibility to protect doctrine in ousting the elected government in Haiti. I put a link into an article based upon access to information documents where the Canadian ambassador in Port-au-Prince cites the responsibility to protect to justify Canada's role in 2004, and another interview with the co-author of the book Canada and Haiti with me, Anthony Fenton, did with the minister largely responsible for Canadian policy in Haiti. Put those links in the paragraph about Canada's role in Haiti. In the article, the editor at the Huffington Post responds by saying, quote, "We need mainstream sources to verify the facts in your blog, and unfortunately the facts below are only in the publications cited or printed elsewhere by the same authors." So basically, the Huffington Post is taking the position that because this information had not already appeared in the corporate media, it could not appear on their website. That, of course, makes life fairly difficult for someone challenging the dominant narrative of Canadian foreign policy. Another example, recent example of bias in the dominant media is that in August, the Green Party of Canada passed a resolution at its convention in favor of boycott, divestment, sanctions targeted at Israeli institutions profiting from the occupation, a partial BDS resolution. That was passed overwhelmingly at the convention, more than two-thirds of the people at the convention, and it was passed overwhelmingly in an online poll in the lead-up to the convention. According to Canada Land, a media watchdog group that looked at a couple dozen stories about the Green Party resolution, it could not find one of those stories that cited a proponent of the resolution. So even though the majority opinion within the Green Party was strongly supportive of the resolution, all the stories were from opponents within the Green Party, notably Elizabeth May, and opponents outside of the Green Party, people like the Israeli ambassador, right? No one from the actual Green Party supporting the resolution. And I just did a couple of events in Alberta and in Ontario with the author of the Green Party resolution, Dimitri Lascaris. And he talked about how in one instance of the Globe and Mail, he actually does this long interview with the Globe and Mail reporter about his motivation for putting forward the resolution, you know, what had happened. Nothing of what he said appears in the paper the next day. So that's another recent example of bias in the dominant media. Over the past decade, Canada has signed foreign investment promotion protection agreements, FIPAs, with about almost a dozen African countries. Basically, what a FIPA is a tool that gives multinational corporations the ability to sue governments and international tribunal for lost profits. So in that sense, they supersede state courts or national courts, so they undermine democracy at that level. They're locked in for 16 years. So if one government signs a FIPA, future governments are beholden, also undermining electoral democracy. And the FIPAs Canada is signing with African governments are really all about Canadian mining interests. Right? Canadian mining interests dominate all across the African continent, about $30 billion of Canadian mining investment. And there's all kinds of conflict between Canadian mining companies and local communities. Many, I list into the dozens of examples in the Canada and Africa book. Probably the worst example is a Barrick Gold run mine in Tanzania, where there's been at least 65 people killed by security forces paid by the mining company over the past decade. Some reports say it's as high as 200 people killed. Basically, the Canadian mining companies operating in different parts of the African continent would like to have these FIPA agreements to have one more tool to put leverage on a government that may concede to local pressures to nationalize the mine, to shut down the mine, or to just increase royalty rates or whatnot. So the FIPAs provide that added leverage to the Canadian mining companies. I could not find a single critical mention of a FIPA that Canada had signed with African government in dominant media in this country. When the Harper government signed a FIPA with an interim government in Burkina Faso in April of 2015, this was an interim government that had was a caretaker government preparing the way for elections after a popular revolt had ousted the 27-year regime of Blaise Compaoré and was basically supposed to be preparing for elections. Harper brought top military officials from the interim government to Ottawa to sign this FIPA agreement that will lock in future governments of Burkina Faso for 16 years. This government has no pretense of electoral legitimacy that will then, future governments will be beholden by it. I wrote an op-ed criticizing Canada's role in undermining democracy in Burkina Faso through this agreement, submitted it to major papers in this country. Not surprisingly, none of them were interested in that op-ed. So these are just a few examples. I list many others in the book, and there's obviously many more out there that I don't go into, of extreme bias in the dominant media in this country around Canadian foreign policy. One reason, an important reason, of course, is who owns the media. It's owned by wealthy corporations. Canada has among the most concentrated media in the world. I list examples in the book of owners intervening in the newsroom on international affairs in different instances. Another structural explanation for the bias in the dominant media is their revenue sources. Right? Much of their revenue, most of their revenue, comes from advertisers, which is largely major corporations. And I go into examples of some of the foreign policy interests of some of the advertisers in Canadian, major advertisers in Canadian media. A notable example, General Motors. General Motors has been one of the biggest advertisers over the past century. For much of that time, General Motors was also one of the largest arms manufacturers in this country, General Motors Defense. The perspective of advertisers tends to seep into coverage, news coverage. Another structural explanation for the bias in the dominant media is that Canadian media is highly dependent for international coverage on U.S. media outlets, Washington Post, New York Times, Associated Press, which tend to have a pro-U.S. slant to their coverage. The book also goes into the Canadian press, right? The Canadian press, the main newswire agency in this country, was set up during World War I with a major subsidy from the federal government explicitly to get more pro-war news to the public. And it was during World War II that the Canadian press cemented itself as the leading news agency in this country. And it did so in part through its very close ties to the military during World War II. to the extent that in one instance, a military PR official operating with a unit in Europe, Canadian military unit in Europe, one day he's working as PR for the military, the next day he's a reporter for the Canadian press with the same unit, right? So just get the sense of how close the ties were during World War II and other wars, and I'm not arguing that they're as close today, but there's still remnants of that. The book also goes through some of the history of the CBC and the CBC's close ties to the foreign policy establishment during its first few decades operating. And there's a couple of very good theses that go into the CBC's ties to the military, and they show how into the late 50s, CBC was actually passing reports by military PR officials to see if it was okay to run them on our public broadcaster. In more recent wars, the military has taken kind of interesting tactics in terms of their information control. Their tactics are different depending on the type of war. So in the bombing campaigns, I'm talking about Iraq in the early 90s, the former Yugoslavia in the late 90s, Libya 2011, Iraq, Syria more recently. The Canadian military has tried to block reporters from having access to the pilots engaged in those bombing campaigns. Right? In the case of Afghanistan, the military basically tried to bring reporters as close as possible. Afghanistan, of course, was not an air campaign. It was a ground occupation war. And in those circumstances, it's a bit more difficult to control some of the information from getting out. So what they did was they brought reporters as close as possible. They brought them onto base to live with the soldiers. So the reporters would go out alongside Canadian soldiers, get in the tank, get in the light armored vehicle. And this, of course, I'm referring to the embedding campaign that most people are probably familiar with. And so basically, the embedding campaign was basically to try to get the reporters to see the war from the Canadian military's perspective. This is how Scott Taylor, a military reporter, described Canada's embedding program in Afghanistan. He said, quote, "What would you say if the Romanian military occupied your town and a Romanian tank and journalist showed up at your door? You love the government they have installed and want these guys to stay. Of course, the locals are smiling when a reporter shows up with an armored vehicle and an armed patrol." It's not that surprising, but it was very rare that you would hear the embedding program described in the media like that, right? These tactics of information control during wars are not haphazard by the Canadian military, right? They are devoting significant energy, resources to thinking through different strategies depending on what type of war, depending on technological changes, depending on what they can get away with, et cetera, et cetera. Like I mentioned previously, the Canadian military is the largest PR organization in this country. Okay. Now, as part of their PR strategy, they obscure the scope of their PR strategy. So we don't actually know exactly how big their PR strategy and all elements of their PR strategies, but we do have a sense. We have a sense. And most of this information is coming from Embassy Magazine, which is an Ottawa-based foreign policy magazine that unfortunately is no longer, through access to information documents. In 2010, the Canadian military spent $354 million on PR and war commemorations. They devoted 661 staff members to the exercise. According to an internal Department of National Defense document, there are, quote, over 13 independent public affairs organizations within the ministry. So presumably, those are all different 13 different PR arms of the military dealing with specific elements of the PR battle. The military has dozens of publications. They spend 10 to 20 million a year on recruitment. Oftentimes, the military and other ministries spend 10, 20 plus million commemorating specific wars. They have major cultural outreach programs, air shows, Canada Day festivities, send troops to Canada Day festivities, Santa Claus parades, NHL hockey games, etc. So the Canadian military spends significant resources on what we call traditional PR, dealing with the dominant media, trying to shape what's in, what appears in the dominant media. Also at the level of cultural outreach, but it goes way beyond that. The military has a history department with 50 employees in the history department. I'm not sure how big the University of Victoria's history department is, but it wouldn't surprise me if it's not as big as the military's history department. It wouldn't even surprise me if the military's history department is twice as big as UVic's. The military's history department has been around for a century, and they produced most of the early books on Canadian warfare, right up until into the 60s. Most of the books on Canadian warfare were coming from official historians of the military. And those books actually had to be okayed by the defense minister. So there's instances where they were debated by cabinet, and cabinet would say, take out this section of the book. There's nothing more important for our ministers to do than to discuss what's in a book about military history. But anyways, so the military's books have had a great deal of influence with that, within academia on covering of warfare. Also, a majority even of the early academics dealing with military affairs, I'm talking right into the 60s, they had their beginnings with the official military section of the Department of National Defense. The military also has its own university, the Royal Military College in Kingston, where the defense minister is chancellor. They also have many what I call describe as arm's length organizations, groups like the Royal Canadian Military Institute, the Legion Conference of Defense Associations, Canadian Global Affairs Institute, Canadian Institute for Strategic Studies, that have either financial, political, or other form of dependence on the military. Many of those groups also receive funding from arms manufacturers. And a lot of the stories you will see on military affairs in Canadian media, they quote people from one of these military arm's length organizations. A lot of the op-eds and papers around military affairs also, they will quote, or they'll be from one of the people associated with these arm's length military organizations. When you start looking into the social sciences or areas of the social sciences related to international affairs in one way or another, it's amazing how many of them, the departments have been set up by wealthy Canadians with a personal view of foreign policy, by corporations, by the Saudi king. Okay? So the Saudi king set up something called the Chair for Dialogue Among Civilizations by providing $5.3 million to the University of Toronto back in 2010. In 2012, Qatar gave McGill's Institute of Islamic Studies $1.25 million. That same year, David Azraeli gave $5 million to Concordia to set up the Azraeli Institute of Israel Studies. David Azraeli is somebody who fought with the Haganah forces in 1948 that were responsible for the ethnic cleansing of Palestine. So this is somebody who has a clear view on the issue. The oldest school of global affairs in this country, the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs at the University of Carleton in Ottawa, it was set up with financing from Norman Patterson, who was a Liberal Party senator, somebody who was very close to Lester Pearson, the lead architect of post-World War II Canadian foreign policy. Many people have a positive view of Lester Pearson. I have a book called Lester Pearson's Peacekeeping, The Truth May Hurt, which gives very much a different story about what Lester Pearson was all about. But Norman Patterson was very close to external affairs. He provided between $4 and $5 million in today's money to set up the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs. And in the book, I show how close the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs has been with external affairs slash foreign affairs slash now Global Affairs Canada over the years, financial ties. Many of the professors at the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs are former foreign affairs officials, etc. The most influential school of global affairs in this country is the Monk School of Global Affairs at the University of Toronto. Are people familiar with Peter Monk? He's the founder of Barrick Gold, the largest gold mining company in the world. In the late 90s, Peter Monk put up $6.4 million to the University of Toronto to set up the Monk Center for International Studies. As part of his initial contract with the University of Toronto, he made it so they had to receive advice from Barrick Gold's International Advisory Board. Okay, this is a public university department. And the Monk School has quite clearly expressed his establishment views. They joined the Harper government's low-level war against Iran in 2012. They received $250,000 from Foreign Affairs, quite explicitly to engage in regime change efforts in Iran. Again, this is an academic institute. They're also involved in the Monk debates. The first ever foreign policy debate in this country was put on in the 2015 election, federal election, put on by the Monk debates. The Monk School is part of that Monk debates process. So they've been incredibly influential in shaping the discussion of foreign policy in this country. And again, just to repeat, the most influential school of international affairs in this country is set up by an individual with a major stake in Canadian foreign policy and has expressed extreme right-wing views. Another area of academic life associated with Canadian foreign policy is international development studies. And between 1986 and 2006, CEDA provided $250 million to Canadian universities. And I'm not arguing that everyone involved in international development studies that are, you know, in a program that is receiving some funding from CEDA, that there, you know, there's nobody criticizing Canadian foreign policy within those programs. I'm not arguing that. But I think if you look at a big picture level, CEDA is an arm of Canadian foreign policy. It's not in the business of funding challenges to Canadian foreign policy. And CEDA has also resisted efforts by universities to have a more independent source of funding for international related affairs, because they wanted the leverage that their funding to universities gives them. They fund a number of the international development studies journals are funded by Canadian Aid Agency, by IDRC, the arm, the Crown Corporation arm of Canadian Aid. Of course, the IDRC or CEDAR, the Canadian Aid Agency, are not funding reporters to go cover Canadian mining company that has destroyed a ecosystem in Ecuador. They're not funding reporters to go cover stories that are critical of Canadian foreign policy, that make Canadian foreign policy, put Canadian foreign policy in a negative light. They fund what serves their, broadly speaking here, they fund what serves their interests. Power, to a large extent, defines reality. There's no better place to see this in recent years than in the case of Haiti. Mid-2000s, Canada was involved in plotting a coup, orchestrating, militarily speaking, a coup, supporting a post-coup dictatorship responsible for thousands of people being killed. Our aid money was going to top officials within the coup government. They were actually employees of CEDA. Other officials, top officials, are employees of USAID. In Canada, Canadian officials were boasting about how we were giving hundreds of millions of dollars, over $100 million a year in aid to Haiti. That money was going to supporting the torturers of the majority poor in that country. But back at home, it was, oh, our benevolence. How is it possible for the gap between that gap between reality and perception? It's possible in large part, a number of factors, but the main explanation is that what capacity do the victims of Canadian foreign policy in Haiti, primarily the slum dwellers of Port-au-Prince, poor rural people, what capacity do they have to tell their story to the Canadian public or to the world versus the capacity of Ottawa, Paris, Washington, the Haitian elite to tell their story? Of course, there's an immense imbalance in resources to deal with on this front. So it's my contestation that the bias in favor of power within ideological institutions in this country on foreign policy issues is much worse than most people believe. Understand. So we need to build a countervailing force. One of the things that I'm doing as part of this tour is we're setting up something called the Canadian Foreign Policy Institute, which initially is just a hub of critical information about Canadian foreign policy. We need to build that countervailing force so it's not just the perspective of the military, foreign affairs, corporate Canada that determines what people hear about Canada's role in the world. I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.